present I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue, the antidote to panel gaze. At the piano is Colin Sell and your chairman is Humphrey Lyttelton.
Hello and welcome to I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue. You join us this week at the seaside in Southport, the fine Lancashire town in the county of Merseyside. Southport as a seaside resort was only really established in the early Victorian era, when the town built Britain's first ever pleasure pier. Following refurbishment, in 2003, Southport won Pier of the Year, much to the dismay of neighbouring Blackpool, which could only manage second place in Toilet of the Month. The Emperor Napoleon III of France lived here in exile during the 1850s. When, to mark the centenary of the event, President de Gaulle arrived on his official jet at nearby RAF Woodvale, as a mark of respect, the air traffic controllers went on strike. Napoleon returned to Paris in 1854 and began the reconstruction of his capital, modelled on Lord Street in Southport, whose town councillors returned the compliment by providing Paris with donkey rides. The people of Paris were delighted by this goodwill gesture, pronouncing the donkeys very tasty. Influences of Southport's architectural style can be still seen in Paris today. The monument of Les Invalides borrows heavily from Southport's Norman church, while the Pompidou Centre was copied from the east face of Quicksave. Another notable Southport local is Derek Akora, the psychic medium who speaks to the dead through an ancient Ethiopian warrior. But Akora's not the only one in Southport with the ability to summon up those no one's heard of from in this. Let's meet the teams. They are, on my left, Barry Cryer and Graham Garden. And on my right, Tim Brooke-Taylor and Jeremy Hardy. And eager as ever to settle down on my left hand, please welcome our fragrant scorer, the delightful Samantha. Okay, the first round is an educational one in which the team's intellectual skills will be visited upon the world of literature. In researching the history of English poetry and prose, the teams have discovered many opening passages of great works which were rejected as unsuitable for various reasons. So, teams, let's hear what rejected opening lines you found for Noddy Goes to Toyland by Enid Blyton. Barry, you can start.
Noddy adjusted the telescopic sight on his Kalashnikov and said, "This is where you get it, big ears."
It is a truth universally acknowledged that a single man in possession of a blue hat with a bell on it must be in want of a wife.
Graham.
Noddy liked the way Dolly closed her eyes when he laid her flat on her back.
Tim.
Go on, Noddy, give us a burst of come on, feel the noise, said Mr. Wibbly Wobbly.
Oh, well, let's try another. We never give up. Daffodils by William Wordsworth. Off you go, Tim.
I wandered lonely as a cloud and rained all over Manchester.
I wandered lonely as a cloud who floats on high over vales and hills, when all at once I met a crowd who said, "We're off to the pub, are you up for it?"
You're dreaming, Barry.
I wandered lonely as a cloud, and I was whistling through my blue lips.
Daffodils are yellow, Byron is blue, De Quincey's a junkie, and Coleridge is too.
Uh, And finally, let's hear your rejected first lines for the Book of Genesis.
You're not going to believe this.
In the beginning, there was a cosmological expansion of space-time and matter from a gravitational singularity, which came as a bit of a surprise to God.
OK, the teams are going to sing for us now.
Oh,
in the round call, one song to the tune of another. Although you'd think that title was obvious enough, I can see by the look of abject bewilderment in the team's eyes that I'd better provide a simpler explanation. A song operates on a very similar level to a power drill. The machine itself represents the tune carrying the lyrics or drill bit in its chuck. The drill bits or words can be removed and replaced by different drill bits for different jobs. Now, I know what you're thinking, teams. Do we need hammer action and vary speed facilities? Well, that's not important. Although the Black & Decker KD960 model is a good one for general use. However, teams, with health and safety very much in mind, you should wear both ear defenders and eye protection. Because there'll be irritating pollutant filling the air. That's right. Piano accompaniment is provided by Colin Sir. Okay, we'll start with you, Tim. Would you please sing the words of "You're a Pink Toothbrush, I'm a Blue Toothbrush" to the tune of "Cum Rhondda"?
You're a pink toothbrush, I'm a blue toothbrush. Have we met somewhere before? You're a pink toothbrush, and I think, toothbrush, that we met by the bathroom door. Glad to meet toothbrush, such a sweet toothbrush. How you thrill me through and through, through and through. And soft to the brush.
You now, Jeremy.
Oh.
He says in a voice of doom. Would you please sing the words of "God Save the Queen" by the Sex Pistols to the tune of "Tulips from Amsterdam"?
God save the Queen, the fascist regime. They made you aim, but I'm not. Potential edge bomb, God save the Queen. She ain't no human being. There is no future in England's dreaming. Don't be told what you want. Don't be told what you need. There's no future, no future, no future for you. God save the Queen. We mean it, man, we love our Queen.
Okay, your turn, Barry. Would you please sing the words of James Brown's "Get Up, I Feel Like Being a Sex Machine" to the tune of "Who Do You Think You Are Kidding, Mr. Hitler"?
Fellas, I'm ready to get up and do my thing. I want to get into it, man. You know, like a sex machine, man. Moving, doing it, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4. Get up, get on up, get on, get on up. Stay on the scene like a sex machine. Catch him, Eric. Go panic.
And finally, Graham, would you sing the words of Roberta Flack's "The First Time Ever I Saw Your Face" to the tune of the Dambusters March?
First time ever I saw your face, I thought the sun run in your eyes, and the moon and stars were the gifts you gave to the dark and the empty skies, my love, to the dark and the empty skies. The first time ever
heart of a captive bird that was there at my command. My love that was there at my command.
Our next game is called Straight Face, in which the players should utter words which must be completely devoid of any comedic content, with the object of rendering the theatre totally silent. Apart, of course, from occasional loud snoring, in which case, could someone please turn me over onto my side? This week, the team's challenge is to recall the punchlines to famous old jokes, but without getting a laugh. Which reminds me, I heard a very funny joke at the end of quote-unquote last week. They said they have a listen-again facility. Good one, Nigel. OK, team, start exchanging your unfunny punchlines. Even the slightest titter from our studio audience will result in elimination. Tim, you can start.
For the fifth time, it's chicken.
I suggest you paint it blue and join the police.
And Snow White said, I only asked for a 7-Up. That was the wind.
And the chef dropped his trousers and said, you tell me, you're the expert.
I said in my Barry voice.
I thought you backed off.
I do James Cagney as well.
Private life is no concern of ours.
And that's why Nicholas Parsons came second.
Sorry, roar of laughter there. I'm sorry. You're out.
Out. Right.
Yeah. Carry on then, Jeremy.
And Robin Hood said, so that's why they call you Little John.
Kermit in a blender.
Nobody told me that electrified the fence.
And the white horse said, how did you know my name was Glenn Fiddick?
No, I'm not having that. Jeremy, out. Which leaves Barry Cryer and yeah. Graham Garden.
Just one, there are hundreds of them.
Wear the fox hat.
Barry?
I didn't ask for a 12-inch pianist.
Why the long face?
Why the big paws?
No, it has to be the bull.
I'm sorry.
Wow. No,
you're right.
No, it was me that laughed.
It's Barry Wynn.
Makes it worse.
I suggest I'll eat grass and you brace yourself.
You've actually won.
Yes. Yes.
Our next round takes us back to the golden days of that perennial children's favourite, Blue Peter. Even that show has succumbed to the electronic age, with children impressing presenters with their skill on a 3 gigahertz computer. Whatever happened to those simpler days when 2 sixth formers could satisfy Val Singleton with a toilet roll tube? So, teams, let's see what you can make with just a few spare household items. Tim and Jeremy, you can go first.
Right, well, I'm starting just peeling these... got some apples here and some pears here, and I'm just going to chop up the apples and some bananas and just put them all together. It doesn't really matter how they go. Just combine them and add a little bit of this.
Hello.
A bit more Leslie Phillips, I think.
Hello. Hello. Hello.
And there we have it, a fruity smoothie.
I've got one here. If you find an organisation in the south of England responsible for this, which in spite of this, provides this, and is now suggesting we drink this, then borrow 8 million of this, and you can delight your little brothers and sisters with one of these. Yes, your very own Mickey Mouse outfit.
OK, Barry and Graham, show us what you've come up with.
Well, yes, now, today we're going to make your own moments from Shakespeare. So we start off with one of these. And add a seven-course feast. There we are, in it goes. And a dash of mood music. And we spiced that up with a bit of this. And it's all topped off with one of these. And there you have it. Macbeth haunted by Banjo's ghost.
This isn't strictly something you can make. It's something I found down the back of the settee at home. It's from the BBC archive. And I'm sure many of you will remember it. I'd like to play it for you now. That was the clocking off shift at a whoopee cushion factory.
And if you take one of these and then using one of these you cut down this and then add a touch of this. There you have it. A lovely strip pine Welsh dresser.
Well, let's draw a veil over that. If that's all right with Jack Straw.
Too clever.
The next round is about letter writing and all that that entails. Barry and Graham, I'd like you to start by composing a letter from William Tell to his son. Then Tim and Jeremy will come up with a reply and so on. However, the challenge is that the letters must be constructed by each panellist alternating one word at a time. And when I honk, it's the end of the correspondence. Or that badger Vindaloo was a big mistake. Off you go, Barry and Graham.
Who is it again?
Barry and Graham.
We're William Tell.
Right. Okay.
Dear
son,
have
you
been
to
the
pub
or
the
greengrocer's
to
get
your
apple
and
take
it
home
and
put
it
on
your
head?
And
you
then
might
stand
and
wait
while
I,
behind
the
bush,
relieved
at
the
prospect.
Therefore,
please
put
an
apple
on
your
head
and
stand
over
there.
And
no.
Not
there.
There.
That's
better.
Close
your
eyes
and
you
feel
nothing.
Hopefully.
Your
loving
dad,
Bill.
Reply from you, Tim and Jeremy.
Dear
Dad,
you
are
a
complete
bastard.
How
ever
I
would
like
to
go
to
university
without having
loans.
So
could
you
pay
for
me
to
go
to
university
so
I
can
learn
some
physics?
But
in
case
you
can't
pay
for
me
to
go
to
university,
I
could
give
you
a
shot
on
a celebrity
Apple
mastermind.
But
nevertheless,
if
you
want
to
go
and
hit
me,
then
fire
away
you,
comma,
and
I
want
you
to
die.
You
are
a
big
dad.
Lots
of
love
from
your
target.
Okay, let's try that again. But with different letters, obviously. This time we'll examine the lost correspondence between Doctor Who and Davros, leader of the Daleks. And you can start us off again, Barry and Graham.
Dear Davros.
What?
Dear, sorry. Dear.
Me.
I am afraid
that
I
was
thinking
you
would
like
to
come
and
see
celebrity
Big
Jesse,
who
will
perform
for
us
tomorrow
some
way
or
other.
However,
we,
you,
and
the
Dalek
hordes
could
possibly
assemble
and
charge
the
celebrity
Big
Jesse's
and
thereby
cause
the
war
that
exists
to
cease,
and
we
could
all
restore
peace
to
the
borough
of
Milton
Keynes.
Your
old
chum
who.
Dear Doctor, I am very happy to make
your
acquaintance. However, I have
plans
for destruction
of
your
patio,
which
is
very
ugly
and
badly
constructed.
You
are
annoying
and
I
going
to
wreck
your
parasol
and
shed
while
I
am
refashioning
all
your
outside
barbecue,
which
smells
of
pork
and
lard,
which
stinks
to
high
heaven,
nuts
of
love
and
kisses
and
hugs
and
feelings
from
front
to
back.
I
am
going
to
exterminate
by
act
of
vengeance.
Love
from
Davros.
That
is
Bobby
Davros.
Well, it's very nearly the end of the show, but it's just time for the teams to announce the arrivals at the RSPB ball. Samantha has to nip out now as she's meeting a birdwatcher gentleman friend with whom she compares notes and photographs. Last time they met, she showed him a chuff. And he produced 12 finches. Graham, will you start by announcing the first late arrival at a society ball for birders, twitchers and other bird watchers?
Ladies and gentlemen, would you welcome, please, Mr. and Mrs. Ross and their son, Albert Ross.
From Israel, Mr. and Mrs. Neagle and their daughter, Golden Neagle.
Here's a rather angry Mr. Roddy. Yes, it's a crossbill.
All the way from Sweden.
Oh, yes.
Mr. and Mrs. Won't You, a seagull's crept on the windscreen. And their son, Olaf, Won't You, a seagull's crept.
You're welcome, please, Mr. and Mrs. over there. No, not there, by the bush. Oh, it's gone. And their son, Luke, over there.
You're welcome, Mr. and Mrs. Twit and their two children.
Very welcome.
Mr. and Mrs. Sir Pretty Boy, then, and their son, Hugh, Sir Pretty Boy, then. They once crossed a parrot with a lion and got a bird that says Polly wants a zebra.
Very welcome indeed. Oh, there's a couple of page three girls. God, it must be cold.
Welcome, please, Mr. and Mrs. Rinduck and their daughter, Mandy Rinduck.
It's an international night. Will you welcome from Madrid Juan Gonzalez, the well-known bird watcher and aviator? You may remember Juan flew over the cuckoo's nest.
And a nice warm welcome, please, for Mr. and Mrs. O'Pigeon and their daughter, Carrie O'Pigeon.
Mr. and Mrs. Finch and their Burberry baseball-hatted son, Common Chav Finch.
And here comes Mr. and Mrs. Bennett, there's a chiff-chaff on the Volvo. And their son, Gordon Bennett, there's a chiff-chaff on the Volvo.
And so, ladies and gentlemen, as the lumberjack of time plunges his axe into the redwood of doom, and the Conservative member for Wokingham gets all he deserves. I notice it's the end of the show, so from the team, Samantha, myself, and the fine folk at Southport, it's goodbye.
Barry Cryer, Graham Garden, Jeremy Hardy and Tim Brooke Taylor were being given silly things to do by Humphrey Littleton, with Colin Sell setting some of them to music. The programme consultant was Ian Pattinson, and the producer was John Naismith. Present I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue, the antidote to panel games. At the piano is Colin Sell and your chairman is Humphrey Littleton.
Hello and welcome to I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue. You join us for a second visit to Southport, the jewel in the crown of England's northwest coast. Southport is rightly proud as the home of Red Rum. The famous racehorse was trained here, running on the sands and swimming in the sea. Red Rum won the Grand National in 1973, 74 and 77. And then in 1978, the 100 metres backstroke. Among Southport's many varied events, the town hosts an annual air show, with visitors enthralled by displays of air from all over the world. This year's event was won by Albert Greasby of Warrington, who gained gold rosettes in three categories: longest piece of air, dried air mounted on card, and mixed preserved airs in a sealed glass jar. Mr. Greasby put his success down to the rich and fertile loamy soil found round his bicycle pump. Every 12th of July, Southport hosts an Orange Men's March. This year included Robert Kilroy Silk and David... and and David Dickinson. Britain's last chief hangman, Albert Pierpoint, lived here in Southport. During a career spanning three decades, Pierpoint is credited with executing 433 men and 17 women, including six US soldiers at Shepton Mallet, 200 Nazis at Nuremberg, and a parking meter attendant in Withenshaw. That last one being a private job. Let's meet the teams. They are on my left, Barry Cryer and Graham Garden. And on my right, Tim Brooke-Taylor and Jeremy Hardy. And eager as ever to settle down on my left hand, please welcome our fragrant scorer, the delightful Samantha. We kick off with a look at our language in the round called Uxbridge English Dictionary. English is a rich and complex language, so it's often difficult to understand the subtle differences in meaning between certain terms. For example, many people don't appreciate the different functions of solicitors and barristers. Well, those of us who've taken the trouble to read our dictionaries know that a solicitor is one who draws up legal documents and prepares cases for court, but is not allowed to plead or prosecute in the High Court. Whereas a barrister is what you hang on to on the stairs. However, meanings are constantly moving on, and I'd like the teams to share with us any new definitions they may have spotted recently. Graham, you can start.
Winnebago, a horse with a bad back.
Tim?
Titillate, delayed puberty.
Barry?
Binge, where Sean Connery puts his rubbish.
Jeremy.
Uganda. Go and have a look.
Carmelite, a half-hearted Buddhist. Carmelite.
Yeah.
Midwifery, partway through breaking wind.
Arboretum, a dockside restaurant.
Mice, plural of mouse, unless said by the Queen, in which case it's the singular. Karma light.
Geriatric, next time Germany starts a war.
Largesse, a largesse.
Surcharge, cash for honours.
A curlicue, a Welsh dog.
Could you explain that curlicue again?
Barry will.
Right.
Carmelite.
Fundamentalist, give money to David Icke.
Sorcerer. Even more of a saucer.
Malady, bit like a duck.
Snuff box, a coffin.
Argy bargy, owner of a narrow boat in Buenos Aires. Bloater, Japanese straw hat.
Pie crust, what you get if you don't polish your pike.
I've been thinking about that curlicue.
Yeah.
I think I've got it.
Good.
Are you enjoying retirement, Humph?
It's a mixture of cur and look you, isn't it?
Oh, yeah, that's right, yes.
Yes,
it's a mixture of cur and look you.
Yes!
I see the next round is all about boasting, with the teams taking roles as swankers. typecast again. Actually, Barry Crowe will be at something of an advantage here, as he really does have something to boast about. Yesterday, Barry was driven to the dentist by his wife and insisted he extract a bad tooth immediately. There was no time to waste on an anaesthetic, as Barry needed to get to the off-license before it closed. So the tooth was pulled, and how brave Barry was in ignoring the excruciating pain as he helped the dentist to hold his wife down. Okay, we'll start with you, Tim. You're at a party and you're just about to initiate a topic of conversation which allows you to boast about something. The rest of you take turns to outdo Tim's boast until I honk, when the next panelist has to initiate a brand new topic of conversation and start the boasting all over again. Okay, off you go. Tim.
I've got a wonderful new gardener with real green fingers.
I've got a gardener for my gardener, both with green fingers.
I actually grew my own gardeners.
Yes, I've just got a little old lady who comes round, but she's got completely green arms.
Oh.
God, right. You're tough, aren't you? I was going to talk about my little old lady that comes round, but it's just as well I didn't have a child.
I have to say that I can always get to see my bank manager.
My bank manager actually lives in the house. He's up before me.
Lives in your house?
One of my houses.
All right.
Blue one.
Not the house you live in there. Yes, they're marvellous, these in-house bank managers. We've got several at home. One in most of the rooms. We've got an ensuite bank manager in the guest room now.
How quaint you should all have it at home. My bank banks with me, in fact.
Oh.
Our nanny is actually comes from Iraq. It's kind of a nanny state now, really, Iraq. Anyone from a war zone is so grateful to be in your house.
Well, you know, that's rather hard to top. But we've got a nanny who comes from one of the most peaceful places on earth. A little place just outside Tring. And she's an absolute godsend, apart from the veil.
I'm really too old to have a nanny, but...
No.
We trained a goat to be our nanny. And a good job.
Our nanny does the ironing, and we don't have to pay her at all, but she's here to learn the language, so I think that's fair.
Our nanny does the ironing, and quite a lot of ironmongery as well. And cast iron work. She's built an entire fence. A cast iron fence right round our youngest.
Our nanny is 14 foot high.
Our nanny's a trained spot welder. Our youngest son got a lot of spots and she welded them all into one enormous spot.
Our nanny can kill a child with her bare hands.
Yes. Well, has introduced the idea of the naughty grave to the family as well.
And another topic.
I taught Gordon Ramsay absolutely everything he knows. It took him ages to learn the C word, but in the end we got there.
Cooking, you mean?
Yeah.
Yes. Yes. Yes, I taught Gordon a couple of recipes, and he uses them in his restaurant, and he's very grateful for them. But I suppose my biggest triumph was when I catered World War II.
Funny you should say that. I catered for the Great War and the Vietnam War and the Korean War and one or two I've forgotten. They were very pleased.
Ah, you've wrong-footed me there, because I was going to say it was a good career move.
I was with Jesus at the Sermon on the Mount, and he turned to me and he said, I've got to feed 5,000 people. We've got some bread and some fish. I said, get slicing, baby. We've got to make these very thin sandwiches.
It's now time to play the game called Mornington Crescent. But first, I noticed from the Mornington Crescent web blog that we've received nearly 7,000 hits this week. which means catapults are making a comeback. We also received this postcard from a Mrs. Trellis of North Wales. She writes, Dear Debrett's, can you tell me the correct way to address an Anglican bishop? I've got him wrapped up, but I don't know where to stick the label. Yours in haste, Mrs. Trellis. This week, teams, as we're in Southport, we'll play a version of the game enjoyed by Emperor Napoleon III of France during his time here in exile. As you know, it's called Mornington Croissant. The game still follows the standard English, ancient and modern rules with a few typically French modifications. Chalk Farm or Shepherd's Bush gain the player a three-move subsidy, and as you'd expect, the mention of any mainline station will cause the succeeding player to miss a turn or go on strike. Tim, you can start.
Frognall Lane.
Very good.
Wren's Park. Oh.
Yeah.
Parsons Green.
Oh.
Oh, you've been practicing, haven't you?
Parsons Green. Oh, no, Piccadilly.
Don't you? Yes. You can't confer.
I wasn't conferring. I was just asking Barry.
Yes, I see your point.
Mm. Terribly sorry, I didn't realise it. Piccadilly. Yay! Yes, you see? Barry agrees.
Piccadilly.
Boarding into it.
Chalk Farm.
Shepherd's Bush.
Yes. Mm. Yes, yes, yes.
OK. Tooting That's Broadway. Right.
Well, that's...
Yeah, that seems clever, but... Temple.
Bastard.
Mornington Square.
Oh, boy.
Oh, well...
St. Pancras.
Yeah.
Yep.
Hang on. It's a mainline station. Oh. And as I said before, the succeeding player has to miss a turn then.
All right.
As nobody succeeded, we'll carry on.
Arnos Grove.
Clapham. Common.
Oh, gosh.
He'll go for it. He will.
Platt's Lane.
He did.
Mornington Croissant. Yeah.
Before we move on, I have to mention that we've calculated that today marks Graham Garden's 15,000th broadcast. And I'm delighted to say he's decided to celebrate by not having sex with a dairy herdsman. Well, we have to move on, but I'm not sure I want to read this bit. It says, the next round we come to is called Complete Bastards. Shocking. Don't they know it's the next round to which we come is called... I brought along a selection of unfinished quotations from some of the world's most unpleasant human beings, such as Adolf Hitler, Benito Mussolini, and Richard Branson. Hang on, Branson doesn't deserve to be included with Hitler and Mussolini. They managed to get their trains to run on time. OK, teams, here are some quotations for you to have a stab at. Jeremy, we'll start with you now. Can you complete this quote of Adolf Hitler? Great liars are also...
Corgi registered.
The answer is great magicians. Now for you, Tim, here's a quick one from Robert Mugabe. The only white man you can trust is...
Michael Jackson.
The very unpleasant answer is a dead white man. Barry, for you, a quote.
Charming.
And another from Adolf Hitler. Make the lie big, make it simple, keep saying it, and eventually...
Finish with a song.
Or as it says here, they will believe it. Finally, Graham, could you complete this quotation of Benito Mussolini? This is the epitaph I want on my tomb. Here lies...
Milan City Council, lamppost 3578.
The answer is one of the most intelligent animals who ever appeared on the face of the earth.
Oh,
he was right, too. Okay, here are some for any of you to have a go at. The first is from Genghis Khan. The greatest happiness is to scatter your enemy, to drive him before you, to see his cities reduced to ashes, to see those who love him shrouded in tears, and to...
finish with a song.
The answer is gather into your bosom his wives and daughters. Here's from a quote from Caligula. I wish the Roman people had only...
fools and horses on TV.
The answer is one neck. This time it's from The Wicked Witch of the West. I'm melting, melting. Oh, what a world, what a world. Who would have thought...
who would have thought I'd be sacked from hosting The Weakest Link?
The answer is a good little girl like you could destroy my beautiful wickedness. Michael Winner, calm down, dear.
It's always been this shape.
I'm not going to insult anyone's intelligence by saying what the answer to that one is. And another one. This line is from Richard III. Shakespeare, it says in brackets. A horse, my...
my letter to Santa has been answered.
Of course, it's Kingdom for a Horse.
Oh. Oh, dear.
And finally, here's one from Saddam Hussein. My name is Saddam Hussein. I'm the president of Iraq, and I want to...
be Al Jolson tonight, Matthew.
The answer is negotiate. We move on to a new music round now. I always think a snappy title is an indication of how good a new game will be, and this one is called... it's a four-part singing relay knockout competition game. Sans Frontier. The challenge is for the four players to sing a song taking one... oh, you are kind.
Humph's Coffin. Is it ready, Humph's Coffin?
The challenge is for the four players to sing a song, taking one word each at a time. Players will be eliminated according to their level of incompetence until only the winner is left, and this shouldn't take too long. Piano accompaniment will be provided by Colin Sell. Listeners may be impressed to learn that Colin has recently been doing...
there was an applause.
Listeners may be impressed to learn that Colin has recently been doing arrangements for the Barber of Seville. It's reckoned to be one of the neatest displays of condoms ever. Okay, teams, your song is Chanson d'amour, and I'd like you to start Barry.
Chanson
d'amour.
Ra da da
da
da.
Play
encore.
Here
in
my
heart,
ra
da
da
da,
da.
More
and
more
chanson
d'amour,
ra
da
da
da, je
t'adore.
Barry, you were late with the da.
I was late with the da, was I?
Yeah, you're out.
Oh, God. It does hurt, Humph, you know.
So you carry on, then. Carry on, Jeremy.
Each time.
Each
time.
Here.
Ra.
Da.
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 Chanson.
D'amour.
Every
time.
Here.
Chanson.
Chanson.
I was moved by that, but security headed me off at the fire exit. Let's try another song. This time it's Run Rabbit Run, and I'd like you to start Graham and get a move.
On the farm
every
Friday,
on the
farm
it's
rabbit
pie
day,
so
every
Friday
that
ever
comes
along
I
get up early
and
sing
this
little
song.
Run, rabbit, run.
Barry.
Rabbit.
What? Not again.
You're out again, yes.
I've come out once. I'm not doing it twice. That closet door's
I'm sorry,
banging
but,
like...
You came in the wrong place. In the wrong game, actually. Righto, you start, Jeremy.
Rabbit.
Run.
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 Rabbit.
Oh. Run.
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 Bang.
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 Late. Late, and also a frog in the voice. Tim, you're out. That leaves just you, Graham, and Jeremy.
Farmers.
Rabbits.
Run.
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 Run. Run.
You're late, Graham. You were late there. Finish it off, Jeremy.
Run! Without. So. Rabbit!
Oh, dear. Well, you've got to cry, haven't you?
Was that all right?
That was brilliant.
It was, yes.
Don't
it should
him.
Have ended on run, but I'm not going to quibble. Well, I see it's very nearly the end of the show, but it's just time to squeeze in a round of Miser's Film Club. Samantha has to nip out now as she's off to see an elderly gentleman friend. She says he's a bit of an old curmudgeon who doesn't like spending his money, but Samantha says if she butters him up properly, she can occasionally get him to splash out. Okay, teams, will you please suggest some titles of films likely to prove popular with an audience of mean old skinflints? You can start this one, Jeremy.
Breakfast at Tesco's.
Tim.
Copperfinger.
Barry.
The Discount of Monte Cristo.
Graham.
Ryan's Private Savings.
Four movies for the price of one. The Magnificent Seven Dwarfs for Seven Samurai.
The Borrowers.
Gordon Brown's School Days.
Titus Andronicus.
Second-hand clothes encounters. Carmelite.
A Fistful of Lira.
Watership Hand-Me-Down.
Bring me the hoard of Alfredo Garcia.
And so...
Some water.
Don't laugh, these are famous last words. And so, ladies and gentlemen, as the smoker of time steps outside for the cigarette of fate and learns how dangerous smoking is if you step out of a cable car, I notice it's the end of the show. So from Samantha, the teams, myself and the fine folk at Southport, it's goodbye.
Barry Cryer, Graham Garden, Jeremy Hardy and Tim Brooke Taylor were being given silly things to do by Humphrey Littleton, with Colin Sell setting some of them to music. The programme consultant was Ian Pattinson and the producer was John Naismith. I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue, the antidote to panel gaze. At the piano is Colin Sell and your chairman is Humphrey Littleton.
Hello and welcome to I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue. You join us this week in London at the Victoria Paris Theatre. This area's most famous attraction is Tate Britain, the art gallery on the site of the old Millbank Prison. During renovation work, evidence of the former use of the building was discovered in the form of a slopping out bucket, which had lain unemptied for a century. A workman dragged the fetid bucket out into the main hall, where he promptly won that year's Turner Prize. A strange piece of art, maybe, but one judged by critics to be particularly fine as the flies follow you around the room. The child prodigy Mozart lived for a time here, where at the age of four he wrote his first two symphonies, the A major and G minor. Comedian Professor Stanley Unwin regularly appeared here. Despite his apparent jolly demeanour, Unwin was in fact a lifelong sufferer of clinical depression, admitting to frequent bouts of feeling suicidal, though. But he's not alone in finding causes of deep depression in these parts. Let's meet the teams. They are, on my left, Barry Cryer and Graham Garden. And on my right, Tim Brooke Taylor and Rob Brydon. And eager as ever to place her comfortable seat on my left hand, please welcome our scorer, the delightful Samantha. OK, we kick off with a new game, which I'm told is going to be riveting. But as the teams are hopeless at metalwork, let's try something else. Now, medical research indicates that very soon nearly everyone will be clinically obese. This means that famous lines from film and TV will need to be rewritten to fit the image of the overweight stars. So, teams, let's hear your fat quotes. Barry, would you care to start, please?
Well, this is legendary line Humphrey Bogart in Casablanca. Here's looking at you, kid. Move over, I can't see the piano.
Arnie, hasta la pasta, baby.
Graham.
Clint Eastwood, go ahead, eat my pie.
And Rob.
Shakespeare, tubby or not tubby.
From Sunset Boulevard. I am big, it's the pizzas that got small.
Clark Gable in Gone with the Wind. Fatly, my dear, I don't river dance.
E.T. Phone dominoes.
The Graduate, Dustin Hoffman. You trying to reduce me, Mrs. Robinson?
The first rule of Fat Club.
Excellent.
What happens in Fat Club stays in Fat Club.
Marlon Brando, I'm going to make him an omelette he can't refuse.
The A-team? I love it when a flan comes together.
The teams are going to sing for us now in the round called One Song to the Tune of Another. That title is largely self-explanatory, but just to clarify the modus operandi, it might be helpful, teams, to imagine songs to be peanuts. The tunes are analogous to the shells which carry the peanuts or words. The shells can be opened up and the peanuts or words removed. Now, I know exactly what you're thinking, teams. Are there not health hazards associated with peanuts? Well spotted, because in certain circumstances, peanuts or words can cause an allergic reaction or stick in the throat. Words such as Colin Sell is at the piano. Okay, Barry, you can start. I'd like you to sing the words of the Teddy Bear's Picnic to the tune of The Windmills of Your Mind.
If you go down in the woods today, you're sure of a big surprise. If you go down in the woods today, you better go in disguise. For every bear that ever there was will gather there for certain. Because today's the day the teddy bears have their picnic. Picnic time for teddy bears. The little teddy bears are having a lovely time today. Watch them catch them unawares and see them picnic on their holiday. See them gaily gad about.
Tim, now you're to sing the words of Uptown Top Ranking to the tune of, to the tune of When You Wish Upon a Star.
See me in me heels and ting. Den checks say we hip and ting. Through them no, no and ting. We have them going and ting. Na pop, no stala, strictly roots. Na pop, no stala, strictly roots. See me on the road, I hear you call out to me.
Rob, I'd like you to sing the words of Madonna's Hanky Panky to the tune of Fly Me to the Moon.
Some girls, they like candy, and others, they like to grind. I'll settle for the back of your hand somewhere on my behind. Treat me like I'm a bad girl. Even when I'm being good to you, I don't want you to thank me. You can just spank me. Mm-mm-mm. Some guys like to sweet talk and others they like to tease. Tie my hands behind my back and ooh, I'm in ecstasy.
Right, Simon Cowell. Finally, Graham, would you sing the words of Simon Says to the Marlene Dietrich tune, Falling in Love Again.
I'd like to play a game that is so much fun, and it's not so very hard to do. The name of the game is Simple Simon Says, and I would like for you to play it too. Put your hands in the air, Simple Simon Says. Shake them all about, Simple Simon Says. Do it! And Simon Says, Simple Simon Says. and you will never be out.
Right, we move on now to our regular public information section on health and safety, a subject we all take very seriously. Only this week we heard about the effects of the smoking ban in Scotland. Drinkers in Scotland wanting a cigarette now have to step outside to a miserable, cold, damp environment, knee-deep in fag ends and litter. The north of England. OK, in the interest of spotting hidden dangers, I'd like you, Barry and Graham, to assume the roles of bride and groom, proposing apparently harmless ideas for your wedding. You, Tim and Rob, are the safety advisors, tasked with identifying the potential health and safety hazards. OK, off you go.
Well, you look a lovely pair. Yeah.
Oh. Thank you very much.
What sort of thing did you have in mind? We should just sort of clear
traditional
up any...
wedding.
It's a very traditional.
You've met my groom, haven't you?
Yes, we are. Yeah. Yes.
He's a lovely looking man.
Yeah. Traditional.
Wendy's going to be wearing a white dress, a white wedding dress.
Yeah, let me stop you there.
Yeah, stop him there.
The white dress, we are finding that is a potential hazard, Tim, with the glare from the white dress.
You can have the white dress, but everyone has to wear dark glasses. That's
right.
What else was
no,
it?
They'll be ringing the bells at the wedding.
Bells?
We like that.
Bells.
You can have the bells. Yes. We're not saying you can't. I want to be very clear about this. We're not saying you can't have the bells.
Well, the
congregation will have to wear ear protectors.
Oh. And dark glasses.
And the dark glasses.
Yes. Now, were you hoping for confetti?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Hard hats.
Hard hats. Yeah.
Well, yeah. Maybe a little bit of grit or maybe a little stone in with the confetti.
Can get in the eye, can't it, in blind people. Yeah, but you've got the glasses on, so you should be all right. Oh, there.
Okay. How do you stand on rice?
I don't know. How do you stand on it?
So can we talk about the transport? How are you planning on getting to the church?
We have a Cinderella coach supplied by the donkey man.
Can I ask, is it open-topped?
Could be.
Yeah, we can't go with you. There is a grassy knoll nearby.
It would
put such a dampener on the day if one of you were to have your head blown off.
It would.
All right.
The reception, what were you thinking of doing at the reception?
Well, usual thing. Cutting the cake, all the traditional.
Oh, yes. I see where you're going now, yes.
What are you thinking of cutting it with?
Well,
a safety cake cutter.
A wild...
For a minute there, we were very worried you were going to say knife.
Oh.
Yeah.
Right.
At the end of it all, where are you thinking of going on honeymoon?
Basra.
Yeah.
That's all right.
That's fine. That'll be fine.
Right, this time I'd like you, Tim and Rob, to assume the role of members of the WI, proposing apparently harmless ideas for a village fete, while Barry and Graham are the safety advisors. Off you go.
Hello.
Tell us about this fete, then, the general scheme of things.
Well, we're very excited.
We're very excited indeed.
Mm. Not overly excited.
Just remember, it's the WI, he said.
Oh, and right. Yes. Yeah. Oh, we're all... Would you like to kick off, Pam? Where is Pam? Oh, I see. Well, we've got a fortune teller.
Ooh, lovely fortune teller.
Brand tub.
Yes. Brand tub. What does that involve?
Bran and some tub. You take a tub and you put the bran in the tub, and that's your bran tub.
That's your tub.
Little more to it than that, really.
And that's why it's called bran tub.
Right. I'm getting spirit messages from Monty Python.
But you hide little goodies in the tub.
What goodies?
And have as
oh. You'd have to put the more popular ones near the top.
any sporting activities?
Athletics, yes, lovely. We've got the maypole, of course.
The maypole.
The maypole, yes.
Yes.
It's traditional.
We'll be doing some pole dancing.
Yes.
Yes, I can see a hazard here.
Oh, where?
The ribbons, I think, I think there could be a bit of a danger to the crowd if some people in the crowd were accidentally caught up in the ribbons.
Yeah. That's a great shame.
They could become bored stiff.
Hard to imagine such a thing happening.
It is. In this day and age, yes.
Is somebody opening this fate? Are you getting somebody
along? Yes, we've put some feelers out.
Yes.
Well, haven't we?
You have, Marjorie.
Yes. I can't stop myself. Yes, we were thinking Abu Hamza.
Yep.
Oh, fair enough.
Because, of course, it would mean we wouldn't have to have scissors for cutting the ribbon.
We'll accept that.
Our next round takes a look at some old newspaper items. I have here an ancient copy of The Times from when David Lloyd George was still the Liberal Prime Minister. Fewer than 2% of households had a telephone, antibiotics had yet to be discovered, and Britain ruled the mightiest empire the world had ever seen. Doesn't that seem incredible now?
Yep.
A Liberal Prime Minister. Also, King George V was still on the throne after 11 years. Following his state visit to India. But today I brought along a selection of incomplete newspaper cuttings from the very day on which I was born, which I'd like the teams to finish off. Right, Graham, you can start. Can you complete this headline from the Daily Sketch? War bond conversion. This is the last week. All applications must be...
in before troops leave for Agincourt.
Well, the answer is sent in not later than Saturday the 28th of May. Tim, now, can you complete this birthday headline from the Daily Mail? Pope appeals for...
leg before wicket.
The answer is, as you probably guessed, peace. Rob, a headline for you to finish off from the Daily Mirror. Lord Inverporth to resign post of Minister of Musicians owing to...
Minister of Musicians?
It's not musicians.
Is that what I said?
Yes. I had such a dilemma then.
I was determined to get us in somewhere. Lord Inverporth to resign post of Minister of Munitions owing to...
revelation that he fires blanks.
Or, as you put it another way, ill health. And Barry, can you complete this birthday headline from the Daily Mail? Gripped by crayfish, girl gripped by the leg by two large crayfish while...
crayfish dancing.
The answer is bathing in Basingstoke Canal. And it's even worse nowadays. Back to you, Graham. How about this from the Daily Mirror? King and Queen of the Belgians pay their...
servants in chocolate.
The answer is state visit to London. Yep. Tim Nark, what about this one from the Daily Sketch? These were all on the day I was born. Fancy. No, I wasn't born fancy. Oh, God, you've got to watch what you say these days. What about...
We forgive him anything. He's a great munition.
Tim, what about this from the Daily Sketch? Advertisement. Eucryl, the choice of the fastidious, makes teeth look...
both ways.
The answer is like pearls. Rob, a headline for you from the Daily Mirror. World's tennis champion loses his luggage, but...
still manages to beat Henman while filling in lost luggage form online.
The boring answer is not his game. And finally, Barry, how about this from the News of the World? Kiss to the pastor. Insane woman interrupts church service. Towards the close of the service, a Trinity United Free Church heir A young woman entered the pulpit while the minister was pronouncing the benediction and, throwing her arms around the astonished clergyman, kissed him. She then addressed the congregation, shouting out,
"Hymn number 11.
That the kingdom of God had come on earth and that she was happy. And there you have it. Headlines from Monday, the 23rd of May, 1921. The day on which I was born, Ireland was given independence, and Mongolia declared war on China. The gestures were appreciated, but everyone else just sent a card or perhaps a shawl. In the next game, the teams are going to construct their own science fiction drama. Now, Barry Cryer is well-versed in science fiction, having played a small role in Planet of the Apes. In preparation, Barry spent many hours with the prosthetics experts, having a huge, floppy, purple backside. Expertly disguised. OK, teams, in your DIY sci-fi drama, I want each of you to take the following parts. Rob, you can be Captain Rob. Tim, you can be Derek Nimoy, the captain second in command. Graham, you're Bones, the doctor. And Barry, you can be the engineer. I shall furnish you all with a selection of familiar sound effects common to the science fiction genre, which you can play in yourselves. OK, your episode is 76 minutes to save the planet. Off you go.
Captain's log, Starbucks on every corner.
Captain.
We must get that door looked at.
Caught between a late door. Captain! Captain!
Repetition.
It's me, Derek Nimoy.
Ah, yes, my trusty number two.
I wish you wouldn't call me that, sir.
Have you seen the captain's log?
Don't call.
Captain, Captain, she cannot take any more.
Well, you have been married for 40 years.
No, 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 it's the boosters.
Calm down, Taffy.
What's that?
Oh, sorry, sir, it's a text from my wife.
What does she say?
She says she cannot take any more.
Captain, Captain, I got here as quickly as I could.
What is it, Bones?
It's a horse. What do you think it is? I have a message.
What is it, Bones? Or may I call you Tom?
Call me Tom. It's a distress call from the planet Carefully. We have just 76 minutes to save them.
76, Tom Bones?
Let the big...
Oh, dear. What shall we do, Derek Nimoy?
We ought to beam down to the planet carefully, carefully, and see if we can save them.
Yes, but what about the dreaded Nagli Dagli monster?
Oh, leave him here.
Right. Come on, trusty crew. Let's go to the planet in the time machine.
Hang on, we're still here.
That's funny. It was working tomorrow.
OK, let's beam down instead.
Oh, we're here. That was quick. But look over there!
So, you have fallen into my trap.
It's Emperor Ming.
Yes, Ming the Liberal.
That's better out than it.
Will the crew make it back to the ship? Will Ming the Liberal have his evil way? More next week.
I cannot take any more.
Uh...
Well, ladies and gentlemen, it's very nearly the end of the show, but there's just time for the teams to... There's just time for the teams to announce the late arrivals at the Fisherman's Ball. Samantha has to nip out now as she's off to see a Scots trawlerman friend whose vessel needs to go in for repairs. Samantha says he's keen to lay her up in the Orkneys. So while she's away helping with that, I'll ask the teams to announce their late arrivals at a ball for those associated with fishing. Graham, will you start, please?
Will you welcome, please, Mr. and Mrs. Klein and Sinker and their son... their son, Hugh Klein and Sinker.
Barry?
Closely followed by Mr. and Mrs. Otts and their daughter, Maggie, known to us all as Mag Otts.
Tim?
Will you welcome, please, a little more sympathetically... Mr. and Mrs. for catching shrimps and their daughter, Annette.
Rob.
Please welcome, late arrival, Mr. and Mrs. Codfingers and their young son, Chris P. Codfingers.
And a very, very warm welcome, please, for Mr. and Mrs. Biggins Lately and their son, Courtney Biggins Lately.
Welcome, please, Mr. and Mrs. at the size of this one. And their son, Luke.
Mr. and Mrs. Twite Shark. And their son, Grey Twite Shark.
There's Noah with a big boatload of carp. He's the carp ark attendant.
Please give a very big welcome. They are quite late. Mr. and Mrs. Mayor and their daughter, Frida.
Will you welcome, please, Mr. and Mrs. Trickiel and their son, Alec Trickiel. Now I said welcome him, please.
a delight to welcome Mr. and Mrs. Teen and their exceptionally tall son, Long Gus.
Will you welcome, please, Mr. and Mrs. Bennett? Look at the size of that crab. And their son, Gordon Bennett. Look at the size of that crab.
All proceeds from tonight's ball are going to a refuge for battered fish.
And so, ladies and gentlemen, as the 4x4 of destiny on the level crossing of fate stalls in the path of the speeding freight train of doom, and the signalman of time rushes to fetch his camera, I notice it's the end of the show, so from the teams, Samantha, myself, and our fine audience at the Victoria Palace, it's goodbye.
Graham Garden, Tim Brooke-Taylor and Rob Dryden were being given silly things to do by Humphrey Littleton, with Colin Sell setting some of them to music. The programme consultant was Ian Pattinson, and the producer was John Naismith. Present I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue, the antidote to panel games. At the piano is Colin Sell and your chairman is Humphrey Littleton.
Hello and welcome to I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue. You join us for a second visit to the Victoria Palace in London, home to the musical Billy Elliot. The show tells the story of a young lad whose dreams are on a London stage. Welcome to my world. In the early 19th century, French prisoners of war were housed in prison ships moored on the Thames at nearby Millbank. However, these ships regularly sank until it was discovered prisoners were tunnelling their way out. With the opening of the Channel Tunnel, Victoria Station became the London terminus of the Orient Express. Well-heeled travellers can make the romantic journey from Venice across the Alpes Maritimes and along the Côte d'Azur before turning north to sip champagne as they're sped in luxury all the way to a points failure at Orpington. The TV cook Nigella Lawson lives nearby here. When she was born, her father, the former Chancellor, chose her name by simply adding the letter A to his own. And she was duly registered as that useless fat gitter, Lawson. An early famous performer at this theatre was the ballerina Pavlova. In 1911, the chef Escoffier created a dessert pudding in her honour, which he delivered here in person. However, before she could sample it, the phone rang and Pavlova's dogs ate it. The famous bronze statue of Pavlova in front of the theatre was removed in 1939. The theatre management can't say whether its metal was taken for the war effort to make bombs or whether it ended up in someone's garden. The answer is both. However, Pavlova isn't the last performer here to end up broken down and bombing. Let's meet the teams. They are, on my left, Barry Cryer and Graham Garden. And on my right, Timbrook Taylor and Rob Brydon. And making a welcome return to keep a keen eye on the team's points, please welcome our scorer, the delightful Samantha. We start this week with a round called Uxbridge English Dictionary. English is a subtle language, and there are those who don't fully appreciate its complexity. For example, many people don't understand the difference between the words atrophy and emaciation. Well, those of us who went to public school know that emaciation is the state of being abnormally thin due to a lack of nutrition or disease, whereas atrophy is what I won for the 50-meter sack race. However, meanings are constantly changing, and I'd like the teams to share with us any new definitions they may have spotted. Graham, you can start.
Crackerjack, a device for raising biscuits.
Tim.
Scandals, sandals with socks.
Barry.
Jocular, Scots vampire.
Rob.
Soaring. Too much fruit in your diet.
Sanctity. Multiple-breasted French woman.
Psychological. Something that makes sense on a bike.
Placenta.
Ooh.
Japanese TV host.
Diabetes. To drop dead whilst making eyes at a wasp.
Gurgle. To steal a ventriloquist dummy.
Already, to suffer from sunburn.
Sex, what the Queen keeps her coal in.
Control. Piers Morgan, A.A. Gill, Victor Lewis Smith, Simon Cowell, Robert Gilroy Silk.
Fibre optic, a bartender's measure for muesli.
Replica, to suck up to the woman from Thomas Cook.
Whoa!
OK, the teams are going to sing along with a selection of well-known discs now in the round called Pickup Song. Samantha Mate... Have you just come in? Samantha made her usual trip down to the Gramophone Library earlier, where there was a bit of a buzz about the release of her latest cookery film. Samantha says the archivists are all very excited about watching her new dinner video. Samantha is now poised at the record deck with this week's selection of discs and ready to give them a spin. You should sing along, teams, until at my signal, Samantha turns the volume down. If on the music's return you're within a gnat's crotchet of the original, I'll be awarding points. And points mean the sharp ends of pencils. What do points mean?
Prize!
This week's prize is sure to delight every dinner party host who likes to serve lawn clippings in style. It's this lovely cut grass decanter. Graham, you're to start, and I'd like you to accompany Peter, Paul and Mary singing Puff the Magic Dragon.
Puff the Magic Dragon lived by the sea and frolicked in the autumn mist in a land called Honalee. Little Jackie Paper loved that rascal Puff and brought him strings and sealing wax and other fancy stuff. Oh, Puff the Magic Dragon lived by the sea and frolicked in the autumn mist in a land called Honalee.
You've all made absolute prats of yourself. OK, you're next, Tim. I'd like you to accompany Harry Nilsson singing Without You.
No, I can't forget this evening on your face as you were leaving, but I guess that's just the way the story goes. You always smile, but in your eyes your sorrow shows. Yes, it shows. My God, it shows. No, I can't forget tomorrow when I think of all my sorrow when I had you there, but then I let you go. And now it's only fair that I should let you go. What you should know, I hope you're keeping on. I can't live if living is without you. I can't live, I can't give anymore. I can't live if living is without you.
You know, Barry. Would you accompany Charles Aznavour singing She?
She may be the face I can't forget, a trace of pleasure or regret, maybe my treasure or the price I have to pay. She may be the song that summer sings, maybe the children autumn brings, maybe 100 different things.
I love you, Barry.
Within the matter of a day, 1, 2, 3. She may be the beauty or the beast. It's going on.
And finally, would you, Rob, please accompany Tom Jones singing Sex Bomb?
Aim, gonna fire, shoot me right. I'm gonna like the way you fight. And I love the way you fight. You found the secret code I use to wash away my lonely blues. And I can't deny your lie, 'cause you're the only one to make me fight. You know what you are? Sex bomb, sex bomb. You're a sex bomb, and you can give it to me when I need to come along. Sex bomb, sex bomb. You're my sex bomb, and baby, you can turn me on. You can give me more and more, I'm counting up the score. You can turn me upside down and inside out. You can make me feel the real deal.
The next round is based on a very old children's game. And luckily, we have four very old children to play. It's called Scissors, Paper, Stone. And one wonders, can that really be turned into amusing radio? Well, in a manner of speaking, no. But why break the habit of a lifetime now? This version is called Cat Glass Pudding. The rules are quite simple, namely that cat breaks glass, glass spoils pudding, and pudding drowns cat. All completely logical. So, teams, I shall count you in, and I'd like you to activate the appropriate sound effect. Are you ready?
Yes.
Yes. Yes.
Okay. One, two, three.
Oh, two cats.
Two cats.
So it's, we start again, do we?
Don't look at me.
I suggest we do.
Yeah, let's try
okay,
it again.
Okay, try again, yes.
We'll try it again.
Yes.
One, two, three.
Now, I did the glass smash there.
Ah.
So I win, don't I?
No, the cat can break the glass.
But think of his paws.
No, the cat wins, I think.
The cat wins, okay.
Cat wins. Yeah. Adjudication, Humph.
No.
Fair enough.
Okay, that's enough of cat glass pudding. Let's play it. Let's play a different version. Off we go, teams. One, two, three.
I was a little late, but what I think our leaves. Those are our leaves.
Rustling leaves. There goes bang to right.
They beat train every time.
Yeah. Should we have another one then?
Yeah.
Yeah, go on. This one, two, three.
Now, we were the gun.
Yeah. It sounded like he shot himself.
While our fellow was using a gun.
I'm beginning to get into it now. Oh. One, two, three.
A walkover for quote unquote.
Yeah.
Wouldn't work so well on television, this game.
Oh, wait a minute. I've goofed.
Is that what you call it?
Yeah. It says on my thing here, you all keep going until it stops being funny. We could all be back home in bed by now. It's now time to play the game called Mornington Crescent. First, I noticed from the huge number of letters which showered in on us this week that the Scrabble factory is blown up again. And then we've received this postcard from a Mrs. Trellis of North Wales. She writes, "Dear Mrs. McCartney, oh dear, what a mess. You must be kicking yourself." Okay, on with the game. And as you'd expect, we'll be playing the standard Metropolitan version today. However, as a concession to Rob Brydon, who's still a relative novice, we'll keep things as simple as possible. So rule two is suspended, and prime move triangulations can be made only within a lateral orbit. Great. Tim, will you start, please?
St. Martin's Lane.
Victoria Street.
No, it's rule two suspended.
Rule two. Mm. Oh, God. Yeah, yeah, sorry.
Right. It's be a lateral orbit, which Humph did say quite clearly.
No, hang on.
Now you're just highlighting the fact we've had to do this because I'm here.
Yeah.
Birdcage Walk.
Embankment.
Oh,
well.
No.
Calm him down.
It's verging on lateral, isn't it?
It's okay.
It's verging on
well,
lateral.
Well, yeah, verging.
He hasn't
verging
played many lateral. Times. It's
well, that's why he's not very good at it, obviously. I don't know.
Only just got
Stockwell.
Away with that.
Stockwell, probably.
Good. Baker Street.
It's actually my turn.
But I'm a right. Bag of nerves.
I'm going to say, I think Rob is right, Baker Street.
Well, no, hang on.
Wait a minute. Triangulations, were you listening?
I think you've been seduced by Rob's cultish enthusiasm here.
You could be right.
What was the ruling on Baker Street, then? Humph, did you rule on Baker Street? I wasn't in the building at the time.
This is my rest period.
So carry on, Barry.
Wigmore Street.
That's it.
Are we stacking the perpendicular?
Is that some euphemism for something?
Because I think we are, and I'll say Hounslow Central.
Oh, very good.
Oh, no.
Yeah, that's no.
Fair play. Very nice.
Yeah, fair play. Camden Town.
Good, excellent.
Metropolitan rules, standard. Obvious. Your move?
Dollis Hill.
Mornington Crescent.
Yeah.
We come to our notes and queries section now, where the teams are presented with some of the most frequently asked general knowledge questions to British newspapers, periodicals, text, and internet sites. However, before we start, we must clear up some inaccuracies that crept into the last edition. Firstly, Richard the Lionheart was not, as we said, a dodgy butcher on Chessington Market. He was, of course, an early patient of Dr. Christian Barnard. Also, when we said that Tutankhamun was the next station on the district line after Tutan Broadway, that was just silly. It's on the northern line. And finally, Anita Harris did not invent liposuction. That was actually Albert Pertabum. Okay, I brought along a selection of odd poses, and I'll ask the four of them to answer these questions. Tim, you can start. Can you think of a simple answer to this correspondence question? What is the most effective chat-up line?
Would you like to come back and watch my remastered goodies DVD? And would £1,000 help as well?
Well, I'm sorry to tell you that the real answer is, according to a recent survey of 1,000 adults, the top two chat-up lines are, "Can I buy you a drink?" and "You don't know me, but I dreamt about you last night." Exactly, I quite agree. Barry, I think this is rather a nice one. Yeah. Does the little dot on an eye have a name?
Conjunctivitis.
The answer is yes, it's called a tittle.
Oh.
Rob, I'm about to do a parachute jump for charity, but I'm disconcerted by the large hole at the top of the parachute. Can you tell me what it's for?
Yes, of course I can. Don't worry about it. It's an access point for the ambulance crew.
The real answer is it's called an apex vent. Before it was invented, air used to spill out from either ends of the canopy. This is why parachutists during the war used to swing from side to side, like a pendulum as they descended. That's another reason. Okay, Graham, how about this question? Is it just coincidence that my finger fits exactly into my nostril?
Yes. Yes, in fact, it's one of several coincidences.
I'll give you the actual answer is natural selection could have played a factor if females in the Pleistocene period preferred mating with males who picked their noses. Or if males and females picked each other's noses in a courtship ritual. If not, then it probably is just a coincidence. Here is something for any of you to have a go. What's a good way to determine whether an animal is dangerous?
Run towards it, waving your arms in the air, and if it backs away, it's not dangerous.
Well, pretty near that is to the railway, which is poking it with a stick is generally...
What is this book?
There's a monument somewhere, people who followed that advice. It is generally considered the most effective. Why are giant pandas in the zoo so bad at mating?
Ah, you're not the first one to have been disappointed.
The answer is the male pandas have the odds stacked against them. I noticed that. Female pandas are only receptive to them for 2 or 3 days a year. If the male pandas try at the wrong time, they get bitten. Added to this, female pandas prefer to choose a partner from a group.
What, like the Stones or...
Take that.
What should I do if attacked by a shark?
Phone Clams Direct.
The answer is keep calm. Maintain eye contact. If you've got a stick... These are all out of a genuine book. If you've got a stick, hold it straight out towards the shark's eye. What is the etiquette... finally. What is the etiquette if I find I'm the first person to arrive at an organised orgy?
Try and make an entrance.
Shower first... Be prompt, bring your own toys, use only mild dirty talk, and take care to alternate sexes. It's very nearly the end of the show, but it's just time for a round of Hospital Patients Songbook. Samantha has to nip out now as she's been collecting donations for a London teaching hospital and needs to deliver some surgical instruments she's been storing. Samantha says she's always happy to hang on to Guy's equipment for them. Especially when they're so hard up. So while she's away doing that, I'll ask the teams to suggest titles of songs suitable to be played on hospital radio. Rob?
See you later, fibrillator.
Jim?
Knees up, Mother Brown.
Barry?
They left my chart in San Francisco.
Graham.
Lady in bed.
I'm getting buried in the morning.
Hey, you, get off my commode.
Papa's got a brand new colostomy bag.
Sergeant Pepper's Lonely Heart Transplant.
ABBA, Booper Trooper.
Mess in a bottle.
The
the trolley and the IV.
Privates on parade.
Lift me up, turn me round, prop me up, turn me round. Lift me up, prop me up, rawhide.
I'm a pink toothbrush, you're a gynecologist.
Plug me in before you go go.
Sung by Placebo Domingo.
Dooby 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 doop, dooby 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 doop, doop doop.
Is this a way to plump a pillow?
STD, all my troubles seem so far away.
And so, ladies and gentlemen, as the milkman of time leaves a pint on the doorstep of eternity, and the policeman of doom arrests him for urinating in public, I notice it's the end of the show. So from Samantha, the teams, myself and the fine audience here at the Victoria Palace, it's goodbye.
Barry Cryer, Graham Garden, Timbrook Taylor and Rob Brydon have been given silly things to do by Humphrey Littleton, with Colin Sell setting some of them to music. Programme consultant was Ian Pattinson, and producer was John Naismith. Present I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue, the antidote to panel games. At the piano is Colin Sell and your chairman is Humphrey Littleton.
Hello and welcome to I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue. You join us on a visit to Sunderland in the fine county of Tyne and Wear. A settlement first appeared here in the 7th century when Vikings stopped off on their way to Greenland. The town was therefore called Sundelund, being an old Norse word meaning who was reading the bloody map. Because of their long association with the making of ships, the people of Sunderland became known as Mackems, or more correctly now, used to Mackems. It was Sunderland's chief constable, Frederick Crawley, who designed the first police box. His concept was taken as the model for the TARDIS, which appears large on the inside despite being quite tiny on the outside. When Mr. Crawley left the force, he took up photography, producing sales brochures for Barrett Holmes. The intrepid BBC reporter Kate Adey was brought up in Sunderland. Miss Adey was present at the storming of the Iranian embassy, the invasion of Iraq, the bombing of Tripoli, and three Turkish earthquakes. When she returned here recently to launch a ship, the crew shot an albatross for luck. Indeed, Kate Adey has witnessed most major disasters broadcast by the BBC. So it's a surprise she isn't here today. As I say, let's meet the teams. They are on my left, Barry Cryer and Graham Garden. And on my right, Timbrook Taylor and Tony Hawks. And if you're sitting with your back to the radio, it's the other way around. Oh, and eager to please as she scores on the desk next to me, please welcome the ever delightful Samantha. Okay, we begin with a round called Inadvisable Openings. This week, the teams are going to suggest various literary openings which were rejected as unsuitable. So, teams, let's hear what rejected opening lines you found for sonnet number 18, Shall I Compare Thee, by William Shakespeare. And off you go, Graham.
Shall I compare thee to Osama bin Laden?
Shall I compare the Royal Variety performance?
Shall I compare thee to a summer's day? Well, you are hot and sweating a bit.
Shall I compare thee to a young man from Nantucket who once put his head in a bucket?
Okay, well, let's try another. Can we have your rejected first lines for Thomas the Tank Engine by the Reverend W. Audrey? Barry, you can start.
Thomas had always had a tender behind.
Good news, said the fat controller. I'm handing over to Mr. Branson here.
Okay, here's another. It's the recently published It Just Occurred to Me, The Thoughts and Reminiscences of Chairman Humph. Can you guess some of my rejected first lines? Tim?
The war was over, I was demobbed, and Napoleon had gone into exile.
It all began when Father Christmas misread my note and brought me a crumpet.
I learned everything I know from Nicholas Parsons.
The first time I met Louis Armstrong, I asked him how it felt to be the first man to walk on the moon.
Okay, finally, let's hear your rejected first lines for Lady Chatterley's Lover by D.H. Lawrence.
Damn fine stuff, this Viagra, said Lord Chatterley, unbuttoning his trousers.
Oh, dear, said Mellors. That's never happened before.
God damn!
But your lordship, exclaimed Mellors, you told me to help myself to the game bird on the kitchen table.
Oh! That's it.
OK, the teams are going to sing for us now in the round called One Song to the Tune of Another. How can I best explain this simply? Oh, I know. A song is very much like a garden lawn. The words are represented by the blades of grass, which are supported by the soil, or tune. However, over time, a lawn may become worn out, so the keen gardener may care to re-turf the lawn with new grass, or in our terms, put different words to the old tune. Now, I know what you're thinking, teams. What happens to the redundant turf that's been stripped off? Well, that's a good point, because you do inevitably end up with some useless sod. At the piano, Colin Sell. OK, we'll start with you, Barry. Would you please sing the words of There Was an Old Lady Who Swallowed a Fly to the tune of You'll Never Walk Alone?
There was an old lady who swallowed a fly. I don't know why she swallowed a fly. Perhaps she'll die. There was an old lady who swallowed a spider that wriggled and wiggled and tickled inside her. She swallowed the spider to catch the fly. I don't know why she swallowed a fly. Perhaps she'll die. There was an old lady who swallowed a bird.
You now, Tim, would you sing the words of Combine Harvester by the Wurzels to the tune of All Kinds of Everything?
I drove me tractor through
your haystack last night. I threw me pitchfork at your dog to keep quiet. Now something's telling me that you're avoiding me. Come on now, darling, you got something I need. 'Cause I got a brand new combine harvester, and I'll give you the key. Come on now, let's get together in perfect harmony. I got 20 acres and you got 43.
Your turn, Tony. I'd like you to sing the words of Knees Up, Mother Brown to the tune of Cavatino, the theme from The Deer Hunter.
Knees up, Mother Brown. Well, knees up, Mother Brown. Come along, dearie, let it go. E-I-E-I-O. It's your blooming holiday. Let's wake up all the town. So knees up, don't get the breeze up. Knees up, Mother.
Very moving. Finally, Graham, would you sing the words of My Old Man's a Dustman to the tune of No Matter What by Boyzone?
Now here's a little story. To tell it is a must. About an unsung hero that moves away your dust. Some people make a fortune, others earn a mint. My old man don't earn much. In fact, he's flipping skint. Oh, my old man's a dustman. He wears a dustman's hat. He wears goblimey trousers, and he lives in a council flat.
Altogether, he looks a proper nana in his great big old nail boots, a great big old nail boots.
It's got such a job to pull them up. He calls them daisy roots. Oh, my old man's a dustman. He wears a dustman's hat. He wears goblimey trousers.
Sounded like the Nuremberg Rally. Our next game takes a look at the doctor-to-patient relationship. OK, we'll start with you, Tim and Tony. You're suffering from an unusual medical complaint, but we'll carry on with the game anyway. You're suffering from an unusual medical complaint and have just been called for your appointment with Doctors Barry and Graham. You must outline your symptoms to them and they will be awarded points based on how accurately they're able to diagnose your condition. The identity of your complaint is now being displayed to our theatre audience via the laser display screen. For listeners at home, here's the mystery voice.
Tim and Tony are England cricketers. Tim and Tony are England cricketers.
Right, start the consultation now, please.
Ah, do come in.
Morning.
Well, now, you look pretty fit.
Oh, that's a good opener.
Yes, it is.
Afraid it's gone straight past me, though.
are you getting enough exercise, do you think?
Well, sometimes around 22 yards. Not very often, though.
So that's a good opener. Is this some indication of the symptoms we want to diagnose?
Well, that's why we answered the way we did.
Could be a clue. 22 yards.
I didn't quite catch that. Again.
You didn't catch
22 yards is a furlong, isn't it?
That's a silly point.
Furlong way. So you find things have been giving you trouble?
Oh, look, can we just stop this examination? We're not used to tests lasting this long.
Any stomach trouble at all?
Well, neither of us have ever got the runs, have we?
I think I see the point you're trying to slip in here. I can't help noticing you've got a fine leg.
Have a look at the other one.
Oh. Yes.
And there's a third man. Oh, dear.
I think there's grave danger that you're turning into the England cricket team.
Oh.
OK, your turn to be the patients, Barry and Graham, and you've just been summoned into the surgery of Dr. Tim and Dr. Tony. The identity of your mystery medical condition will now be displayed to the audience via the laser display board, while here again is the mystery voice for listeners at home.
Barry and Graham are a pantomime horse. Barry and Graham are a pantomime horse.
Start your consultation now, please.
Good morning.
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 Morning. Good morning.
You're
morning.
Looking pretty
what
well.
What did he say?
He said good morning. He said good morning.
Right.
Yeah.
Who did?
The doctor. I told you, we've got to see the doctor.
They're doctors, are they?
Yes, they are.
Oh, was that you?
Well, who else could it have been? Yeah, just keep your feet still. You'll trip us up. Yes, doctor, sorry.
Yeah, well, how long have you, you know, been suffering with this?
Oh, well...
What did he say then?
He said, how long have we been suffering? No, he's a big responsibility for me, and I was hoping for some respite if I could, get rid of him for a while. But don't let him hear us saying that.
Are we still in there?
Well, yes, we're still here. Yeah. Look, just amuse yourself chasing the flies away, will you?
You can't be.
You can't be. You're not pantomime horse, are you?
That was 10 minutes of my life I won't get back. Okay, the next game is all about sound effects. The creation of wireless sound effects makes a fascinating study, but sometimes even the BBC's technical experts can make mistakes. It was recently discovered that the seagulls on desert island discs aren't the type found in the South Seas. As a result, the programme had to be renamed Council Dump Records. In this game, one team will improvise vocal sound effects to complement the story being told by the opposing team. Tim and Tony, you're to start. I'd like you now to relate your tale. And Barry and Graham, I'd like you to provide the sound effects. OK, Tim and Tony.
It was the opening day of Parliament. The Queen arrived to be greeted by the band of the Grenadier Guards. Who were between numbers.
Then the band struck up.
Oh,
a friendship with those nice boys from the Coldstream Guards.
The crowd waited patiently for a sight of the Queen, only to be interrupted by the sound of the band. Of the band protesters who had been pushed their way to the front with their anti-monarchist banners.
The Queen stepped out of the coach, followed by her favourite corgi, registered gas fitter. And finally, it was time for the Queen's speech. To be placed next to the Queen's apple, the Queen's orange, and the royal pair, who'll be divorcing in July.
And then the Queen announced all the brilliant new policies of the Blair government.
Okay, your turn to tell a story now, Barry and Graham. And you're providing the sound effects this time, Tim and Tony. So, Barry, Graham.
Pirates of the Spanish Main. Captain Jake stood on the poop deck.
Worried by the silence. And at that moment, he heard the cannon roar.
Good morning. Good morning, Reverend. What's your problem? Said Jake. Reverend Spooner. Reverend Spooner explained that he did not wish to walk the plank.
I do not wish.
But Captain Jake was merciless. At sword point, he forced the Reverend along the plank, step after step.
Go. 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 Go, go, go.
Oh. Oh. Oh.
Go, go.
In his stocking feet. With a despairing cry, he fell off the end of the plank.
Oh! Splash!
Onto the cargo of interior sprung mattresses.
Boing, 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 boing. In their steel container.
Ow! Ow! Ow!
Shiver me timbers, exclaimed Captain Jake. And Pegleg Pete immediately obliged.
Oh, for that you'll get 50 lashes.
Ow! Ow! Ow!
And this complimentary mascara to go with them.
The end.
We move on now to a round about the dying art of letter writing. Barry and Graham, I'd like you to start by composing a letter from Richard III to the Little Princes. And then Tim and Tony will come up with a reply and so on. However, the challenge is that the letters must be constructed by each panelist alternating one word at a time. And when I honk, it's the end of the correspondence. Off you go now, Barry and Graham.
Dear
both,
I
would
like
to
see
you
later
on
today.
However,
when
you
are
here,
it
will
be
appropriate
for
you
to
be
slightly
pissed.
Furthermore, I
wish
to
take
this
occasion
to
say
to
you that
I
must
immediately
dispatch
a
speedy
assassin
whoops
to
the
Tower
of
London,
where
you
will
shortly
be
resident. I
hope
this
finds
you
as
it
leaves
me.
Your
loving
Uncle
Dick.
Reply, please.
Dear Uncle Dick, nobody ever understands
us.
We are small,
very
small, almost tiny.
However,
all of our time is spent climbing up to the window where we can see a woman outside her clothes. Wow! Talk about crumpet. She's got two enormous brothers who stand outside our window and sing lots of horrible hits from the 60s. Yours sincerely, the Princes.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, it's very nearly the end of the show, but it's just time for the teams to announce their late arrivals at the Gardener's Ball. Samantha has to nip out now, as she has a gardener gentleman friend coming round who's going to teach her how to deal with her seedlings. Samantha says she can't wait to observe him prick out in the potting shed.
Stop that.
So while she's away enjoying that, I'll ask the teams to announce the late arrivals at the Society Ball for Gardeners. Graham, will you start, please?
Will you welcome, please, Mr. and Mrs. Dendron and their daughter Rhoda Dendron.
What ho?
Mr. and Mrs. Aishus Border and their son Herb.
Tony.
Please welcome Mr. and Mrs. Path and their diminutive daughter, Wee D. Path.
Tim. Oh, look, here's Cynthia Payne. Hiya, Synth.
Closely followed by the Mother's Union with Chris Evans. That's Chris and the Mums.
Oh, there's Graham Garden in his garden gaiters. Now, that's a proper gaiter.
All the way from China.
Really?
Yeah. Yes. It's Mr. and Mrs. Basket and their son, Hang Yin Basket.
Also from China, Mr. and Mrs. Willow and their tiny son, Wee Ping Willow.
Will you welcome Greta Garbo? Don't bother her, she wants to be a lawn.
And there's Mr. and Mrs. Nightshade with their late son, dead Lee Nightshade.
It's Mr. and Mrs. Steep and their aged relative from Yorkshire, Compost Steep.
Welcome.
Oh, I'm ready to throw in the trowel.
Aye, aye, that's your lot.
There's Mr. and Mrs. Bennett. Look at the size of that cucumber. There's son Gordon Bennett. Look at that size of that cucumber.
And so, ladies and gentlemen, as the thermometer of destiny drops below the freezing point of fate and the Geordie lad of time slips on the sleeveless T-shirt of eternity, I notice it's the end of the show. So from the team, Samantha, myself and the fine folk of Sunderland, it's goodbye.
Barry Kyer, Graham Garden, Tim Brooke Taylor and Tony Hawkes were being given silly things to do by Humphrey Littleton, with Colin Sell setting some of them to music. The programme consultant was Ian Pattinson and the producer was John Naismith. We'll be right back. present I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue, the antidote to panel games. At the piano is Colin Sell, and your chairman is Humphrey Littleton.
Hello and welcome to I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue. You join us for a second week at the Empire Theatre in the fine city of Sunderland. The family of the first US president, George Washington, came from this area. It was George Washington who led the revolt by the American colonists as they no longer wished to be treated as the subservient lackeys of Britain. Well, he certainly reversed that one. And so the War of Independence began, and soon Americans were raining cannon salvos down upon their former British allies, a tradition they proudly preserve to this day. Sunderland is rightly proud of its fine football team. In 1989, Sunderland AFC were required to turn their old Roker Park home into an all-seater stadium. But the scheme failed when the team found it nearly impossible to play the long ball game sitting down. Instead, a site for a new stadium was found at nearby Monkwearmouth. Work on the replacement ground began in 1996 when it was labelled the Wembley of the North. However, as the city wanted it completed before the entire team... before the entire team died of natural causes... it was renamed the Stadium of Light. That name was borrowed from Benfica Stadium in Lisbon because of the obvious similarity between the two cities. Lisbon is a coastal city of constant sunshine, boasting Baroque and Romanesque architecture, whose cultural heritage makes it a mecca for writers and artists. And Sunderland is also on the coast. The author Lewis Carroll was a regular Sunderland visitor and set sail from here on his journey to China. Carroll's inspiration for the name Wonderland came when he heard the word Sunderland and simply substituted the first letter. Luckily, he wasn't going to Nanking. Let's meet the team. They are on my left, Barry Cryer and Graham Garden. And on my right, Tim Brooke-Taylor and Tony Hawks. And the lovely lady who has for many years been my right hand, please welcome our scorer, the delightful Samantha. Okay, we may as well get on with it. We start this week with a word round called Uxbridge English Dictionary. The English language is complex, and there are those who don't fully appreciate its subtlety. For example, many people don't know the difference in use between the words forbear and abstain. Well, if one chooses to refrain from a certain activity, then it's appropriate to say one abstains rather than forbears, because forbears is one more than Goldilocks had. However, meanings are constantly changing, and I'll ask the teams to share with us any new definitions they may have spotted. Graham, you can start.
Reproach to harvest fish.
Splinter, Chinese 100-meter runner.
Goblet, a small mouse.
Tony.
Catastrophe. Feline punctuation.
Dentist. Someone who repairs car bodywork.
Climate. First instruction at mountaineering school.
Mishmash. Sean Connery, late for church.
Oh.
Newcastle, minor suburb of Sunderland.
Doldrum, an instrument to play while queuing at the DSS.
Shamrock, polystyrene boulder.
Damnation, Holland.
Appetite, cheerfully drunk.
Dildo. Pickle in pastry.
Mitosis, what's on the end of my feetsis?
The teams are going to sing along to some well-known discs now in the round called Pick Up Song. As usual, record researcher Samantha went to fetch the team's records from the gramophone library earlier, where she found the kindly old archivist sampling wines for Christmas. He'd brought in a selection of French wines, but there wasn't much left by the time Samantha got there. So although she was disappointed he only had a Semillon, she said... She thought it would be impolite not to taste it anyway. Samantha is now back and poised in DJ mode at the record deck, ready to give the team's discs a spin. Each member of the team should sing along with his record until, at my signal, Samantha turns the volume down. If on the music's return teams you're within a midge's minim of the original... I'll be awarding points, and points mean prizes. Izzy Wizzy. This week's prize is sure to delight every amphibian lover who worries about their pets getting lost. It's this lovely AA Toad Atlas. Barry, you ought to start, and I'd like you to accompany Gene Vincent singing Bebopalula.
Bebopalula, she's my baby. Bebopalula, I don't mean a maybe. Bebopalula, she's my baby. Bebopalula, I don't mean a maybe. Bebopalula, she's my baby love, my baby love, my baby love. She's the girl in the red blue jeans. She's the queen of all the teens. She's the one that I know. She's the one that loves me so.
Gene's lost it, hasn't he?
Okay, you're next, Tony. I'd like you to accompany Pinky and Perky singing Baby Love. And we've provided this helium to assist you.
Mom, I need you, oh, I need you. But all you treat me bad. Break my heart and leave me sad. Is the helium working? Oh my God, did I do wrong to make you stay away so long? Baby love, my baby love, I'm missing you, miss kissing you. Instead of breaking up, let's do some kissing and make it up. Don't throw our love.
You know, Graham, would you accompany Scissor Sisters singing I don't feel like dancing?
Don't you start. Up in the morning with a head like what you done. This used to be the life, but I don't need another one.
Good luck cutting nothing, carrying on, you wear them gowns. So how come I feel so lonely when you're up getting down? So I play along, can I hear that favourite song? I'm going to be the one who gets it right. You better know when you're swinging round the room. Looks like magic's solely yours tonight. But I don't feel like dancing when the old Joanna plays. My heart could take a chance, but my 2 feet can't find a way. You think that I could muster up a little soft shoe devil sway. But I don't feel like dancing, no sir, no dancing.
Beep-a-palula, cheese.
And finally, would you, Tim, please accompany Anne Stevens singing Buckingham Palace?
The changing guard at Buckingham Palace. Christopher Robin went down with Ellis. Alice is marrying one of the guard. A soldier's life is terribly hard. Says Alice.
Nurse, the helium.
They're changing sex at Buckingham Palace. Christopher Robin is now called Alice. The sword guard in the sentry box. One of the soldiers is knocking off his socks. Says Alice. They're changing guard at Buckingham Palace. Christopher Robin went down with Alice. Naughty boy. We looked for the king, but he never came. Well, God take care of him all the same.
We were down with Alice. We were down with Alice.
I rather like that idea of gassing the teams. The teams are going to display their thespian skills now in a game called Sound Charades. This is similar to the erstwhile TV favourite Give Us a Clue, which comprised three essential elements: silent mimes, expert players, and an ecstatic audience. The team's version differs only slightly in the first respect, but completely in the other two respects. The original programme is no longer aired, but the undisputed mime master of Give Us a Clue is still Lionel Blair. Yay! He now tours the country doing exhibition performances in bars and restaurants, but sadly, last week's show had to be cancelled. Lionel's van broke down on the M6 and he had to pay £50 to be pulled off into a little chef. Tim and Tony, you're to start, please, and your title will shortly be displayed to the audience via the laser display screen. For listeners at home, here's the mystery voice.
The Antiques Roadshow. The Antiques Roadshow.
Right, you're guessing this one, Barry and Graham, and off you go, Tim and Tony.
It's three words, actually. It's a television show.
So, Sunderland tonight?
Yeah,
where
wonderful.
Were you last week?
We were at Victoria Palace, actually.
Ah,
yes,
right.
Moving around tomorrow.
Okay.
Actually, you don't really qualify, do you?
Give me another decade and I'll be there, really, yeah.
The end.
Travelling, dates.
Yeah.
Tony
dates.
Not really qualifying.
What's the difference between Tony and the rest of us?
Whoa,
I'd like
old.
To boycott this line of thinking, please.
We're old.
Is it celebrity wife swap?
Now there's an idea.
Old is there, and
old.
Three words.
What is this? Is it a
tour? Show?
What?
Old show.
Show old.
Something show.
Something road show.
Something, antiques. Yes.
Antique, yeah. Yes. Antique road show.
Yeah.
Right, right, your turn, Barry and Graham. Your title is now being exhibited on the laser display board. And here again is the mystery voice for listeners at home.
Wyatt Earp. Wyatt Earp.
Two words.
Yeah, two words.
Film.
A film. Two-word film.
Right. Yeah, Dougal! You'll have had your tea.
Oh, no, I'm not here for tea. I find myself in need of some turps. Do you have any... do you have any turps I could borrow?
Oh, turps, let me see. Well, I've got just the one.
Oh, well, one is all I need.
Whatever do you want it for?
Oh, I see what you're asking.
Terps, as in turpentine, is it that sort of?
Terps.
Is terps.
What we said.
One terp.
Terp. What do you want the terp for?
Yeah.
Why I want a terp? I see why you're asking.
Wyatt Earp.
Wyatt Earp. Oh.
We take a look at the world of cinema in the next game with some classic movie strap lines. The 20th century certainly produced some wonderful movies. One thinks of A Night to Remember, telling the tale of that fateful night aboard the SS Titanic as the mighty steamship hit... Now, hang on, I mustn't ruin it by giving the ending away. Now, as sought-after actors go, Tony Hawks will be at something of an advantage in this round, as we were surprised to learn that Tony recently instructed his agent to turn down Casino Royale. But his agent threw him the remote and told him to turn it down himself. OK, we'll start with you, Tony. Can you complete this tagline from the film, Braveheart? His passion captivated a woman. His courage inspired a nation. His...
accent was all over the place.
The real answer, which I have to give for the listeners at home, because they're all taking notes, heart defied a king. Your turn, Tim. Could you complete the strapline from the film version of John Steinbeck's classic Of Mice and Men? We have a dream. Someday we'll have a little house and a...
hole in the skirting board.
It should be a couple of acres, a place to call home.
Oh.
Barry, here's a strapline for you. The long goodbye. Nothing says goodbye like...
a wreath.
The answer is a bullet. And Graham, for you to finish off, we have the strapline to... Brokeback Mountain, love is a...
pair of chaps.
That is force of nature. Tony, you again, for the strapline to Cape Fear. There is nothing in the dark that isn't there in the light, except...
that coffee table that I just banged my shin...
The answer is fear. Tim, now, can you complete this strapline from the film Cat People? She was one of the dreaded cat people, doomed to slink and prowl and caught by night, fearing always that a lover's kiss might...
lead to noisy sex on the garage roof.
Meow?
The answer is change her into a snarling, clawing killer.
Ooh.
Barry, here's a strapline from The Postman Always Rings Twice. If there was an 11th commandment...
it was lost in the post.
The answer is quite close. They would have broken that too. And Graham, how about the strapline from the film Babe? A little pig goes...
well with apple sauce.
And the answer is, of course, a long way. Yeah. OK, here are some for any of you to have a go at. Memoirs... this is from Memoirs of an Invisible Man. Women want him for his wit... the CIA wants him for his body. All Nick wants is...
for people to stop bumping into him.
The answer is his molecules back. How about this strapline from The Omen? Good morning. You are one day closer to the end of the world. You have...
reached the Samaritans.
The answer is been warned. Can you complete this strapline from The Island of Dr. Moreau? Through DNA experimentation, Dr. Moreau has upset the balance of nature. By turning animals into humans, he's...
created the Osbournes.
The answer is turned heaven into hell. Here's a strapline from the film Scanners. 10 seconds, the pain begins. 15 seconds, you can't breathe. 20 seconds.
Switch off, quote unquote.
The answer is you explode. And finally, how about this strapline from The Saint? Never reveal your name. Never turn your back. Never
drop the soap.
The answer is surrender your heart. We have a musical round now with Swanee Kazoo. Hey! This is the round in which the teams combine the soothing lilt of the Swanee whistle with the chirpy rasp of the kazoo. What was once an unlikely combination, Swanee and kazoo are now words that roll off the tongue together as naturally as slash and burn or urinary and infection. Piano accompaniment will be provided by Colin Sell. Listeners will be fascinated to learn that Colin used to play with Van Morrison. Whenever he was playing with Morrison, Colin would use the greeting, Van the Man. And in return, Morrison would cheerily reply, Sell the piano. Tim and Tony, you can start, and I'd like you to provide us with a rendition of the Georgie Fame song, Yeah, Yeah, to feature Tony Hawks on the kazoo and Tim Brooke-Taylor on the Swanee whistle. OK, Barry and Graham. Now, Barry and Graham, I'd like you to provide us with a rendition of Mana Mana to feature Barry Cryer on the kazoo, Graham Garden on the Swanee whistle. Well, ladies and gentlemen, it's very nearly the end of the show, but there's just time to squeeze in a round of Dog Breeders' Songbook. Samantha has to nip out now as she's meeting a gentleman friend who she thinks is planning to buy her a spaniel. Samantha says she's not sure if he's going to get her a King Charles or Cocker in the pet shop. So while she's away enjoying that, I'll ask the teams to suggest song titles likely to appeal to an audience of dog breeders. You can start this one, Tony.
All you need is Ruff.
I'm a daydream retriever.
I want to hold your hound by the Beagles.
Peek and easy like Sunday morning.
My old man's a Doberman.
Pit bulls, pit bills, who need pit bulls?
And an all-time favourite with dogs, I'm peeing on a lamppost at the corner of the street. Shirley Bassett singing The Man with the Golden Retriever.
Or the miniature schnauzer, the joint.
If I were a bitch man...
I'm going to sit right down and breed myself a litter.
Airedale Vice.
Hold it, flash bang wallop, what a pincher.
Another one bites the dustman.
A whiter shade of pal.
Pearls a Springer.
You're 16, you're beautiful, and we're having you put down.
I lift my hind leg up, my hind leg.
Mastiff men and mastiff cats and dogs.
And so, ladies and gentlemen, that's the end of the show, and indeed the series. Oh. And what could be worse news than that? Well, there'll be another series in the spring. So, from the team, Samantha, myself, and the fine folk of Sunderland, it's goodbye.
Barry Fryer, Graham Garden, Tim Brooke Taylor, and Tony Hawkes have been given silly things to do by Humphrey Littleton, with Colin Sell setting some of them to music. The programme consultant was Ian Pattinson, and the producer was John Naismith.